Today we are going to talk about this.
It is without doubt the most beautiful aircraft ever to evolve from the mind of man.
The Concorde retired in 2003. Ever since then, we've been stuck traveling at regular old speeds. But there is a company in Colorado called Boom. They've raised more than $150 million to build the first privately funded commercial supersonic plane. The company was started by a man named Blake Scholl. He came from the internet and software world, but decided he was going to be the guy who would make this machine possible. And so they've been at it for a few years. Overture is the goal. And before that, they are building a plane that's about a third the size of this thing, which is called XB1. And Boom is unveiling it for the first time, and we get the first look at it. So let's head to Colorado and hear from Blake about Boom's progress. And with that, off we go to Colorado. So I've been following you guys since what? Since like 2015, 2016?
I think it was early 2016, yeah.
Give me the whole thesis behind Boom and what you guys are trying to do.
It's been really half a century since we've had a speed up in air travel. We went from props to jets in the late 1950s, and in the 1960s and 1970s, we made the leap to supersonic with Concorde, but we never made high-speed travel mainstream. And in fact, when Concorde shut down about 20 years ago, there was really no plan to pick up where it left off. And so that's what we're doing at Boom. We're building high-speed travel that can be available to more people than ever before. So think New York to London in 3.5 hours instead of 6.5. Think the West Coast to Tokyo in as little as 4.5 hours. Think of Overture, which is our airliner, as chopping off the front cabin of a Boeing or Airbus widebody and making it go really fast. So it's got between 65 and 85 seats, and we'll get you there, you know, wheels up to wheels down, in about half the time it takes today.
If you fly XB1 next year, that would be the first private supersonic plane. Is that right?
That's right. When we fly XB1 next year, it'll be the first independently developed supersonic jet ever.
Okay. Tell me just a little bit about your background, and in retrospect, do you think that's been a service to what you guys are trying to do?
I went to school for computer science. I started my career at Amazon doing automation of online marketing as a software engineer and then as a leader. But I've loved airplanes since I was a kid.
You fly, right?
And I've been flying for fun since college. You know, I'm one of those people that, you know, you let me behind the controls of an airplane, and you know, you got to wrest them out of my hands because it's so it's so much fun. And it's such a just a wonderfully human thing to do, and technical and physical at the same time. But I've been watching the supersonic space since I was in my mid-20s, and I sort of gave myself a life goal of going Mach 2. And one day I wanted to have my passion for aerospace intersect with what I was actually working on, and I had no idea when that would happen or how it would happen. But I feel very lucky to be able to do Boom.
Why has it been since 2003 that nobody tried to do this again?
We're now at the intersection of what is technologically possible and what there is a sufficient market demand for. So since Concorde retired in 2003, there's been a 2.5-fold increase in international travel. And that creates a lot more markets for supersonic. At the same time, we've had all kinds of new technology that didn't exist in Concorde's day. We've gone from aluminum to carbon fiber composites. We've gone from loud, inefficient, environmentally unfriendly turbojet engines to turbofan engines that are much quieter, much more fuel efficient. And when you put together all the new technology, aerodynamics, materials, propulsion, you can now build an aircraft that's significantly more efficient than Concorde, which means it can be available to tens of millions of people at fares kind of like what you'd pay in business class today.
So you guys are doing this in this super methodical way. You're unveiling right now this XB1, which is your first plane. And tell me about it. I mean, it's basically a third of the size of where you're hoping to go with Overture, which will be your first commercial plane.
So XB1 is our, think of it as our like baby prototype for Overture. We call it Baby Boom for fun.
Okay.
And it'll go supersonic. It'll be history's first independently developed supersonic jet. And you know, for those of you who are familiar with the early days of SpaceX, it's in many ways analogous to the Falcon 1. Rather than going and building Overture, we decided it was prudent to take all of our best ideas for that airplane and then go subscale and do design, build, fly, learn on a representative aircraft that is as human rated that, you know, actually carries a living pilot. So we'll be flying XB1 and setting speed records in 2021, so next year. And then as XB1 goes supersonic, around the end of next year, we're going to pass the torch from XB1 to Overture. And so all the things we've learned in flight test of XB1 will inform the final design of Overture. We're going to press enter on that around the end of next year, and then start signing up the rest of our supplier team for Overture, do the detailed design. And in 2025, so about 5 years from now, we will be with Overture where we are with XB1 today, where we're rolling out the first assembled airplane, and then we'll be in flight test starting in 2026 with Overture. So 6 years from now, you'll be able to look up and you'll see an Overture aircraft, you know, in the skies, setting speed records. And so we'll be carrying our first passengers by the end of the decade.
Cool. Well, I think we can actually sort of like have a peek down on the factory floor, right, with XB1 kind of coming together.
Yeah, let's go take a look at it.
Here we are overlooking XB1 in its assembly hangar. So this is a 67-foot-long aircraft, so about one-third of the scale of Overture, which would be a little bit more than 200 feet long. And over here, we've got about a 21-foot wingspan. So this hangar that we're in here is perfect for XB1, but Overture wouldn't even fit in the building. So this, we're gonna move here in a couple years as we start building the first Overture aircraft. So the last few components are going on, and then we're going to lower the aircraft down onto a field. And then we'll be ready to unveil the aircraft for rollout.
How many people do you guys have working on the plane right now?
We've got about 140 people in the company, and you know, of which about 100 are working on XB1, either physically putting it together or finishing the design, the engineering of it. You can see here we've got the main landing gear that's designed to take 200,000 pounds of load.
Okay,
we can provide even a relatively rough landing. And up above it, this is the intake. So XB1, like Overture, it's got three engines in it. So we've got one on each side underneath the wing, and then we've got a third one in the tail with an intake that's mounted dorsal in the back of the airplane. So we've built this deck so the airplane can be accessible for installing systems, and we call it the party deck. Building an airplane is like building an iceberg from the bottom up. Pilot sits here, but you can get a sense that, the visibility over this nose isn't going to be great. And that's why we've got the camera system that allows the pilot basically have a virtual window that goes through the nose of the aircraft, and they can see the runway better than they could on a typical subsonic airplane. You can see that we've got the nose cone is on now, and we've got that silver thing sticking out is the flight test boom. So that's a piece of equipment that measures airflow, airspeed, air pressure, temperature, well outside of the interference of the airplane itself. You kind of reach forward, you get a clean measurement, and then we use that to calibrate the sensors that are elsewhere in the air. There are many, many, many sensors throughout this. And then the whole airplane has a real-time data link down to the ground, about a 10 megabit link. And so we've got real-time video feed, plus all of those sensors fed real-time off the aircraft down to the control room. So we've got carbon fiber composite wings, and you'll notice that the wings are relatively small compared to typical airline wings. So that's one of the artifacts of a high Mach design is you have relatively less wingspan, and that but you've got so much airflow over the wings, you can still get all the lift you need. And then the trick to making it also work at low speed is you come in at a very nose-high attitude, you know, called a high angle of attack. And at that point, the whole aircraft is in something called vortex lift, where basically you get a vortex generated off the nose, you get a vortex generated off the leading edge of the wing. And a vortex is basically, I think of it as like a little bit of air that's swirling. And so it's faster than typical air around it. And you'll remember from, you know, Bernoulli's principle that faster moving air has a pressure drop. And so that vortex you have sitting above the wing generates a low pressure region relative to the high pressure below the wing, and that's how the airplane flies subsonic.
Well, it's amazing, man, and thank you so much for your time today, and it's exciting to see, you know, how far you guys have come over these last few years.
Well, thank you, Ashley. You've seen it from the very early days, and it certainly has come a long way.